sorry for my bad English. Well, next speech has a very singular name, How to Ride a Blue Whale. Isn't it beautiful? Now we are going to see basics of riding this new blue whale and help yourself with containerization. I'm so sorry. And orchestration. we are going to talk about, we are going to listen to Nemanja Cimbaljevic talking about Doppler. So I have to tell you something about Nemanja, because Nemanja is the second time that is coming to welcome Las Palmas de Gran Canaria. Last year he was a volunteer, and he's a PHP developer, WordPress enthusiast, an open source advocate. And I like one sentence I read in the biography, because she said, WordPress is idea and cause. So let me introduce you to Nemanja Cimbaljevic. Thank you.
Thank you. Hola, that's like the furthest I will go with Spanish, I guess, in this talk. So yeah, we're here today to talk a little bit about Docker and how it can maybe help you improve your working processes and how you can use it on your development, what Docker is and what definitely isn't. As being said, I'm a PHP developer. I started working in 2004-2005. Basically work in PHP most of my time. WordPress is just one of the passions that I have, and lately I jumped into the server architectures, DevOps, and all that stuff. So here are some fancy terms that usually we'll try to sell to our clients, like containerized apps, microservices, Kubernetes Swarm, dev-like production, continuous integration, blah, blah, blah. That's not what I will talk today. So not Docker in this sense. First thing I want to just make a distinction is what Docker isn't. A lot of people tend to mix it with virtual machines, and in a sense it's not really that. If we check like this, let's say we have the same set of three applications, this top set. The big difference comes on the hypervisor level, where when you have a virtual machine, you will need to have like a hypervisor that will provide your environment for the guest operating systems. For Docker, you don't have that. It relies on top of your kernel. This means if you try to do something like running Docker on Windows machine without virtual machine, it will most likely fail. Like most of them will fail if you try something developing on Windows. But sometimes it will even fail on OS X. So it's not just about Windows. This is something we run internally in our company for development purposes. So as you can see, we are running the virtual machines and Docker on top of that. So that's one thing that usually people mix. So you can't use them together. It's not I will use either this or that. Anyway, let's dig into some terms that can make a confusion for first timers. Who here uses Docker like on a daily basis? Okay, who tried it and after 5 minutes not figuring out how it works, just pushed it away? Yeah, thank you. Okay, I was in that group for like a year. I tried it, it didn't work out, and I just pushed it away. So first, there's an image. Consider this, how many developers we have, like PHP developers, Java developers? Oh yeah, that's great. So consider an image as a class. So it's just a replication of what you will have when you create an instance. So it's your starting point. It defines some set of commands, some functions, libraries that you will have included in your container later. It's stateless, definitely, and it will not change unless you make a change in it, but in that case, you're basically creating a whole image. The next thing, we have a container. It's a runtime of your instance, so it's literally, if you shift it to the developers, vocabulary, it's like when you create instance on a class. It can change in time, but it will be based on that class that you had originally. And the host. What I mentioned before, like the host is the machine that will run your Docker, and on top of that, you will have your containers. Try not to mix different operating systems when you try to do this. Once again, I tried it on Windows first time, it was horrible, and that's why I pushed it away. As I mentioned, we will not talk about some fancy things, but I will stick with CLI commands and how you can easily set up your environment, how you can easily, in like, I don't know, 5 minutes, get going with your WordPress development using the Docker. So it's not really a workshop, but I will show the actual commands and how you can do it. First, like on Windows, like I said, I installed it a long time ago. On OS 6, there is now an UI for Docker, but to be honest, I don't use it. You can simply install it using the VM. That's my setup. So I have a VM. In that VM, I have Docker installed as a CLI, and everything I do, basically, I do from the VM. Synchronization works properly, so you will not have a problem with that, most likely. I had one developer who actually had a problem when he tried to sync the data from the container to his operating system level, his host level. It just didn't work. So we just reinstalled Docker all over again. All of a sudden, it works. So gremlins. I don't know how else to say it. Like any other command that you have in the CLI, the Docker also has its own command. It has set of options that are different per container, per image you're using, and it usually can be fine in explanation for that image. The good thing about Docker is for different images, you don't have to build them yourself. You can use Docker Hub, where you can find various images and just push them up as you need them. One of the examples I saw on the Docker conference was a guy who received a RAR file on OS 6 in 2018. It was like, how should I do this? Like, I don't want to install. He actually used Docker. He pulled over the Docker image for uncompressing the RAR files. He uncompressed that file on his local machine using Docker. So, and all that, it takes about, to download and to execute, let's say, 30 seconds. So even faster than to just download the whole application and do that. The good thing about Docker, on the other hand, is its speed. Let's say you want to run a VM. You run, let's say, Vagrant up. It will take, how much, 15 seconds to get your machine up and running. When you run this command, if you already have image downloaded on your machine, it will take about, let's say, a third of a second. Your machine will be up and running. So it's really great for testing, it's really great for quick development, but you can play with that on your own. So if we take a look at this particular command, we are trying to run like arguments here, MySQL 5. That means that the image will try to take with that tag. So I will go from back front. Why I have to use the tag 5? Because currently the official MySQL image is running on version 8. It will most likely break most of your systems. So I say I want to get that image. These are a bunch of options that I will use to set up that image. So in this particular case, I want machine name to be this. WordCamp last time was MySQL. Why this, we will see later, because Docker has internal networking that will, you will not have to make like IP addresses or something. The whole netting thing, the whole networking thing is done inside the Docker, and you can use the names you define here. And yes, of course, don't do this even in development if your colleagues can access like MySQL allow empty passwords through. So that means the root will have absolutely no password. Everybody can see if your port is exposed on your local network on your machine, everybody can access your address. So we will just run this and let it be there for a while. One important command that really can help you is Docker PS -A. Why always use -A? Because then you will see the images that are even in a the containers that are out there. The Docker will not allow you to run the same container twice. Even if you have the same name, that container is put offline, you will not be able to run it again with the same name. You will receive an error. So try to use a name and check your status. Like that's the important part. Container ID, it's important, but I will more focus right now on names that container, or of the name of that container. To some more fancy geeky stuff. Now I want, without actually accessing the shell of that container, to just execute the shell databases in that, running on that container. So I run docker exec. This is the name of the container I want to access. And from here, like MySQL user and execute is actually MySQL command, just basic MySQL command that you will use in the CLI. And of course, I will get a result. So I didn't even access the shell for that container. I can run this from my host machine. All I need to know is the name or the ID of that container. That's why I explicitly put a name in, because if I didn't, it will receive some generic name, and then I will always have to use PS to list all the containers, copy, paste, blah, blah, blah. It's much, much easier this way. So, of course, the idea behind this is, after the third slide, to have a running WordPress in Docker containers. So we want to create a database named WordPress. I picked that name specifically not just because it's a WordPress event, but you will see later when we come to the WordPress image. And I just want to make sure that this works. So I'm running, like, after creating a database, I want to confirm that I really have that database. So after running this command, I will receive no result, because that database is perfectly empty. It still doesn't have nothing, so it's perfectly normal. And just to confirm once again that I really have the database, if I run the show databases, I will have my WordPress database listed. Keep in mind that I haven't used in the original command, all the data that are stored for this machine will be available only inside that container. If container is deleted, all the data that container contained are also deleted. So if you don't have external mounting point, you'll lose all your data in this particular case. Okay, now we have a database, we confirm that everything is fine on that end. And we will try to set up a WordPress using just this few lines. So I want to run, again, a Docker container named Las Palmas WordPress, and I want to link it to work in Las Palmas MySQL. The semicolon and MySQL afterwards defines that it will communicate on specific port for MySQL. This is the networking part that I mentioned. This is enough for Docker that knows where to look for that container. It doesn't need an IP address. It will receive an IP address, of course, 127 point something, point something, point something. And it will automatically be assigned. But it's not something you actually need. You just need to remember the name, and you can use it in your configuration. So like when you set a VP config file, you simply put the name. You will not put localhost or something like that. You use this name, and the Docker knows exactly where to look for that container. Dash P is port. With this, we are, if there is no this part, if we don't put an P option, this will return a faulty result that the connection was rejected. Why? Because I'm trying to access my localhost on port 80, that's basically not exposed. So you can keep your ports inside Docker. They will not be seen from outside, but inside you can communicate with all the containers you have. Slash daemon, of course, won't run in the background, so it will not shut down right after we execute the command. And again, we set up an image name, which is WordPress. So one command here, and after that, if we run ps, we see both our containers running. the result of the local host will, as you can see, be installed PHP. Of course, with some automation, you can set up everything in just how much, like, I've been talking about this for the last 8 minutes. To actually run all this, you will need just about 1 minute, and you have your WordPress container fully running. You can test whatever you want, kill it afterwards, and that's it. No need to, like we usually do it, set up a VM, then set up a database in a different VM if I want to keep all my databases in one place, or I will set up my local MySQL server, blah, blah, blah. It takes much less time, much less effort, and it kind of speeds things up. And yes, if you really like CLI, it's really fancy. Okay, so there is even faster way than this. So this wasn't fast enough. We can use Docker compose. It's again a CLI command that will take one file where you set all your containers in one config file, similar like you will have for Composer or something like that. It has its own structure, its own documentation, and uses pretty much the same things. I don't know how much you can see from that. Like, big enough? Okay. So again, I want to set up services. Those services are basically containers that will be created. I want this name and this name. I want to use image, MySQL 5.7. I could use 5 or doesn't really matter. Volumes is something that I introduce here. That means that even when I drop this particular container, the volume will still stay on until I explicitly remove the DB data volume, or I remove the Docker altogether from my host machine. So this will override the issue that I mentioned before with using the just simple Docker run MySQL CLI command. You will lose all the data. In this case, the next time when I say I want to link my DB data to varlib MySQL, I will receive all the data that was stored there before. Unless, of course, I didn't explicitly remove it. Some environment variables, and this will be the definition for my MySQL container. Then we are jumping into the WordPress one. We say it depends on the DB one. That means if this container is not up and running, this one will not even try to start because it's pointless. It will just show an error and that's it. We will use the latest WordPress image. And talking about images here on Docker Hub, both is MySQL and WordPress are official images. So that means they are being maintained by the companies behind the project. The least possible that you will have some issue that's not been discovered before, and even if you discover a new issue, you can report to those companies. If you go with unofficial images, you will have to go back to the developer that is working on God knows what, and most likely can answer in like weeks from that moment. Again, we are setting the connection for our WordPress BP config file, where there's a slight error here. I just put a DB. It should be VC Las Palmas DB and running on port, of course, 3306. This will again bring you the same result as we had before, but just in one file. And the good thing about this, you can keep these files per project level. So let's say you're working on one project, you will just do Docker compose up there. Basically, that's it. You will run a Docker, you'll push it in the up state, you will get both of your instances up and running, you're finished with that project, you want to move to another one, just do Docker compose down, it will bring down that one, you can bring up the other one. And again, all this, if you have images on your machine locally, it will take just a matter of seconds, or maybe 2 or 3 seconds for some more complex stuff. When I first started working with Docker, it wasn't really production ready. But in the last year and a half, really it got to a stage where you can say, okay, it's pretty stable. It will not create some weird issues where it will just all of a sudden go down, which used to happen before. Now it's not so much like you're just working on something and your container restarts. Why? No, no idea, just it does. This is something we're working on in our company as a service for WordPress, where we will use the set of containers for every client. It's pretty much like a shared hosting, but in a different way. Like Docker also has some fancy features like limiting number of ports you can use for that container or limiting amount of memory you want to allow that container to be used. But it has the better shelling option, so it's harder to get out if one WordPress site gets hacked. It's, I would not say impossible, nothing is impossible in the IT, but it's really hard to reach to the others. Like even if you are running, let's say, CloudWorks, you can do that, but with Docker, it's a little bit, it's a little bit better. So on the right, I just listed like some of the basic services that we'll try to use, and we are still experimenting how we can use one environment when it comes to VP includes for all the clients. So we will just mount that on one place and your client's files on the second one. And yeah, we were talking about containers for so long, like here are some containers if no one's seen them before. But yeah, pretty much this is like how your Docker host will work, just you will not have container, but actually you can, because you can have multiple containers of the same kind stacked on top for some optimization if you want to split into your resources. So, yeah, that was it.
Does anybody have any question to Nemanja?
How can I access data in Docker volumes?
It depends where you put them. With this approach, you will have to connect to that actual, to any container that has access to that volume, but you can use shared volumes where you will have that data on your host machine, so you can easily just access them from your host machine. That's what I said, it will be synced across. The sync process fails miserably on Windows, tested a few times, it doesn't work. On Linux, it works perfectly because you don't need a VM. On OS 6, maybe it works, maybe it doesn't. In most cases, it works, but it can fail, then just seriously reinstall Docker and it will work.
Any other question? No? Okay, so...
Thank you. I'm very curious because I need to sometimes to perform test cases. I just wanted to know which platform do you recommend for starting up making experiments with it? Which platform do you recommend for starting up making experiments with Docker?
My setup is OS 6 with CentOS 7 in a VM, and then I run the whole Docker on top of it. But to my developers, I usually recommend a dual boot if they are on Windows. So like don't even go with the VM. Or on OS 6, you can easily go with Vagrant, and that works. At least in my experience, it worked with no problems.
Okay, any other question? Well, let's give an applause to Nemanja.